everybody. Welcome back to Silver Lining. I'm your host, Juliet Vine. This is South Florida Fair 2020, and I'm currently fangirling. It's been a lot, but I am here with an iconic person. She is gorgeous. She is smart. She is a mom. She's like a superwoman, and she's just a total queen. Please welcome Miss America 2011, Teresa Scanlan.
Now, that is quite the introduction. Thank you. It's good to be here. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for being here. I am so excited to meet you, and I'm so excited to ask you all these questions. You have easily one of the most interesting reigns and like winning stories that I've read about, so I'm really excited to hear your side of the story.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Well, I'm excited to share. It's weird that it's been almost 10 years now, so January will be 10 years for me, so it's kind of cool to be able to talk about this and relive it 10 years later.
And you're still so young. I was looking you up and I was like, oh, maybe she's like, you know, 31, 32 now. It's been almost 10 years. And I'm like, she's 27. That's crazy. You are like literally so young. And I realized, oh my gosh, she was literally a newborn when she won Miss America. I'm 19. I consider myself to be pretty mature. And I was like, I could not have done that at 17. You know, I was worrying about my homework, not worrying about representing the nation. So it's different. So if you're ready, I'm ready to ask.
Absolutely. Now go for it.
All right, cool. So my first question for you is when and how you first got involved with the Miss America organization, and what do you believe you learned along the way that led you to your Miss Nebraska and then national win?
Oh, goodness. I definitely learned a lot. I started when I was 13 years old, so I had never competed in a pageant before. Pageantry was actually something I wasn't even that exposed to, so I grew up in Nebraska, and honestly, pageants, especially for younger kids, aren't that common in Nebraska, and so I had never even watched Miss America before. I had no idea what it was, right? So about 11 years old, I think it was, I saw an advertisement in the newspaper for the local county fair pageant, and you could start competing when you were 13. And I always knew that I wanted to go to law school from a very young age. That was my goal. And so I was looking for ways to earn scholarship money, and the county fair pageant offered, I think for the teen division, it was something like a $200 scholarship. But, you know, at 13 years old, how are you going to win a $200 scholarship? So I figured, okay, this could be a way to start earning scholarship money. So once I turned 13, that was the first pageant that I did, and I did end up winning somehow. wasn't expecting that, but it kind of lit a fire in me. It was something that I actually loved and I didn't realize I was going to. Began to use it to be able to perform my piano pieces, which I really loved. It was kind of something that encouraged me to be well-rounded and to focus on each aspect of my life. And I think that's something that I learned through the years as I competed from 13 to 17 is, to challenge myself in every area, in academics, in volunteer service, in my talent, in physical fitness. So it really just helped encourage and motivate me in each of those areas of my life. And I'm the kind of person that I love to have a goal to accomplish, and I'm very competitive. So if you show me someone who's doing something well, I'm going to want to do it too, and I'm going to want to compete, right? So it tapped into, I think, all of those natural parts of myself, became something I was really passionate about. So I continued to compete throughout the outstanding teen pageant through those 4 years. And then once I turned 17, because I graduated high school a year early, I was eligible to start competing for Miss Nebraska and Miss America. And I didn't expect that it was going to happen so quickly. I definitely, I had a long-term plan to keep competing throughout the Miss America organization until I aged out. So I was planning on going to Virginia, starting college there, and continuing to compete. But obviously that didn't happen.
Obviously not. And you were saying you got started at 13, and I bet you weren't thinking at 13 in 4 years, I'll be Miss America.
No. Yeah. And that's exactly it. Right. So I think I was 15. Yeah. It must've been about 15 when I watched the Miss America pageant for the first time. So, you know, at 15, very first time ever seeing the Miss America pageant, there was no way I thought in 2 years, I'll be on that stage competing. Right. So it definitely seemed like this very far away dream that might happen at some point, but so far in the future. And it just happened a lot faster than I had expected.
I was reading an article that I quote a lot in my questions from your current law school, UC Berkeley, which is very impressive. And you'll be graduating from there this coming year, or this next year, which is very exciting. But they said that you described it as like a change in plans, like not supposed to happen. Like winning Miss America was like unexpected. And right. I don't know why you were like, well, okay, that's great. Wasn't planning on that. But
because yeah, one thing to know is that I am a planner through and through, right? Mm-hmm. So my mom and I were very much all about the 10-year plan, always making a 10-year plan, right? So that was part of graduating high school early, that I knew I wanted to go to law school. You know, I had my 10-year plan for sure, that I wanted to graduate early specifically to finish undergrad earlier, to go to law school sooner. And then honestly, in my plan, right, I thought that I would maybe compete for Miss America when I graduated law school at 24. So in my mind, I had pictured this whole, oh, I'll be accomplished and I'll be smart and I'll be older and I'll be ready to go at 24 years old and finally compete at Miss America, and that'll make my chances really great. So that was the plan. And then winning Miss America became a huge change in plans. That was, yeah, very unexpected. And it was like, okay, let's go with this and see what happens.
Only 7 years early. That's like barely anything.
And so honestly, because it was 7 years early, I just thought that meant my chances had been completely blown. So I really, when I went to Miss America, I thought 100% Nebraska had never won. A 17-year-old hadn't won in 70 plus years. So I completely thought, okay, this means that I can't win, but I just want to do my best. So that was really the mindset I had going into it.
Teresa Scanlan, Miss Nebraska.
Yeah, because it's truly crazy, because you really only hear of super young winners back in like the 1930s, 1920s, and Miss America's formational years. And really the only super young one was at 15, Betty Cooper in 1937. So even after all those years when Miss America set up age requirements and everything, and you just made the cutoff by like a week or something crazy.
Yes.
It's pretty unheard of that you were like the second youngest Miss America 70 plus years after, like you said. It's crazy, but...
Right.
I mean, it blows my mind still, because I knew you were so young, but I didn't realize 17 like that.
Right. So yeah, and you know, one of the pieces that fell into place was the fact that I graduated a year early, and so that made it where it just fell perfectly in that sort of what's normally a gray area for a lot of contestants, is that you have to have graduated high school by the time of the state pageant. And back then, I think they changed the age requirement now, but you had to have turned 17 by the time of your local pageant. So that was the requirement when I competed. So I turned 17 in February, and there was one final local being held 1 week after I turned 17. So that was the one local I could compete in to try to go to Miss Nebraska. And I figured, just, you know, go for it. Probably won't win, but whatever. And then I did win that local, and that was my ticket to Miss Nebraska. And Miss Nebraska was luckily 2 weeks after I graduated high school, so I also qualified for that piece. So it just worked out where all pieces fell into place. And of course, winning Miss Nebraska was not expected the first year. I figured I would compete for several years. So when I was, you know, sent to Miss America 6 months later, that was definitely a lot different than I had thought.
Right, because it is really rare. Most girls try for years and years, which is expected. It's hard to win, even a local, you know, sometimes you have to try. And, you know, I was talking last time to Miss America 1977, who had a clean sweep. She won her local, state, and national, like within the span of 10 months. She was also 21 years old. So, you know, it's crazy how you see sometimes people who don't expect it at all come out on top. It's like, I'm fascinated by it, honestly. And, you know, girls try for many years for good reason. But my second question is, you know, usually, like, how many years did you serve locally, and how do you think those years of service led you to, you know, or prepared you for nationals? But how many local titles did you serve? Probably not that many, since you just made the cutoff.
Oh, right. Well, so if we count Miss America's Outstanding Teen, then then it was a total in the Miss America and Miss America's Outstanding Teen organization, 10 pageants that I competed in. Okay. So throughout my teen years, that's where I would say in those 4 years competing in Outstanding Teen, those were the formative years that I think really did impact. Right. Later competing in Miss Nebraska and Miss America for sure. You know, I won some, I lost some, which was another reason it was unexpected, is just because, you know, yeah, you hear the stories, sure, of someone just competing in three pageants and then winning the whole thing. Right. The reality was, you know, even my background in Outstanding Teen was sometimes I would win a pageant, sometimes I wouldn't. I never even placed at the state level at Miss Nebraska's Outstanding Teen, you know, so I really didn't think, oh, this is something I'm great at and I win every time. No, it was, you know, it was a pattern of wins and losses and just learning as I went. But looking back, I realized that that really helped me the most, because it was not through winning that you learn the most. It's really when you lose titles and you not only have to deal with that, but then it inspires you and encourages you and motivates you to, you know, compete even harder, to change things, to improve, to do better. And so all throughout high school, that was what was helping me, you know, and really spurring me on throughout. And I do think that that ultimately led to my being able to win Miss America quickly, was, you know, all that prep work that had been done for those 4 years.
So it's not like you were coming in here, you know, not even, you know, knowing how the system worked. The Miss America's Outstanding Teen system is pretty similar. Of course, there are a few key differences, but it just goes to show how much it can prepare you and how much it can build you up and really change you throughout those 4 years that you said you competed in. I am wondering, though, you know, I find it so inspiring when, you know, winners, like especially national winners, say, oh, yeah, I've lost locals in my life. It wasn't like I was always, you know, everyone said, oh, that's going to be Miss America one day. You've had struggles and you've had triumphs. Mm-hmm. So I love hearing that. But I'm also wondering, when you went into your first year as a Miss, won Miss Nebraska, won Miss America, like that. But teen, it wasn't always so easy. Do you think sometimes that there are winners, or there are candidates rather, who are better suited for Miss than the teen organization, and they just have to come into that?
Oh, certainly. Certainly. That was 100% my case. So in Outstanding Teen back then, I don't know if this is still the case, they allowed you oftentimes, especially at locals, to get your written feedback back from your judges. So I often was able to get, you know, feedback, which helped so much. And I loved that, because then you could take it and learn where to improve, right? So specifically from interview, that kind of thing. And so consistently, my feedback was always, you don't seem like a teen, be more teen, be more of a teenager, let yourself be a teenager, you know, all these things. And that was never my personality. That was, you know, and it felt not authentic to try to be whatever the idea of a teenager was, right? And it's not to say anything against the judges or the program or whatever, but like you said, it's not a fit for everyone, because the issue is that as an outstanding teen, the idea is for you to be able to relate to other teenagers, right? That's the whole role. And I honestly struggled with that, because I probably didn't relate to most teenagers, because right. I kind of was in a different track, different mindset in life, that sort of thing, that I just was never able to get into that, really being able to relate to other, you know, people my age for the most part. And so it was later that all of a sudden all of that came in handy, and it wasn't a problem anymore that I came across older and had, you know, some different ideas and a different personality, I guess. So you know, I think that early on it would have been not at all genuine for me to try to force myself to have some type of personality or appearance or something that fit in an outstanding teen profile versus just waiting until I competed later. And so I'm glad that, you know, I stayed genuine and authentic, where I just felt like I was always doing my best and not trying to be like somebody else. And then that paid off once I entered the Miss program. And I think sometimes that even works in reverse. Sometimes we have contestants who are amazing and outstanding teen, and it's such a good fit for them. And then maybe that doesn't always carry through to the Miss America system. So, you know, it totally depends on the person. But one other piece I want to say about that is just something I always tell contestants every time I work with them, is that different judges, different winner every time.
Yep.
You can never say just because somebody won or lost this pageant means they're going to win or lose this pageant, right? It's a different set of judges every time. So from locals to state pageants to Miss America to everything, everyone is just a different set of judges, and you're not going to be everyone's cup of tea, and that's okay, right? And so it sounds cliche, but it's just true. And I saw that throughout the time I was competing, you know, different judges, different winner. If we had a different set of judges at Miss America that year, I wouldn't have been Miss America. It would have been someone else, right? So just, you know that, yes, you can do your best. Yes, you can compete at your fullest, but different judges mean a different winner.
Absolutely. And I really like hearing you say that because I am a product of the teen system. I competed twice at state, and this will be my first year as a Miss, which is exciting. But I never felt like a teen either, so it makes me happy to hear you say that because I was watching you compete, you know, obviously when I was, you know, like, fangirling and I'm her and I'm watching her, but you never seemed like you were 17. You did not look like you were 17. I mean, maybe you look like 20 or 21, but that's not even the point. The way you carried yourself, the way you spoke. And of course, I see some insanely talented teens. I think anyone that's able to win a title has to have a really good talent, really great talent. But your talent was like, you know, like full-blown adult. Like it just never really struck me as like a teen. So it's really nice to hear you say that some people are more appropriately fit for one system and some are more better fit for the other. But I will agree with you that teen definitely, you know, formulates a lot of what you are as a Miss, you know, a lot of the lessons you learn, you know, speaking publicly, it's very educational. But yeah, I could totally see what you're saying. You were like a Miss probably from day one. I mean, you like didn't even seem like you were 17 up there. It blew my mind. It still blows my mind. I keep saying it. You're like, yeah, I know I was 17. Thanks for reminding me.
No, I appreciate that. And you know, it's funny because even like you're saying with the talent piece, right? Initially, early on, I had played whitewater chopsticks for some of the teen pageants as well. And often, I think every time actually, it won the talent award. But every time, you know, directors and people were trying to get me to make it more like, you know, look at the audience and wink and smile and do these things. And I just felt so awkward doing that. It wasn't me, right? They're great ideas. And for some people, they would love that and they would feel great about it. But for me, I knew that I would cringe and I would have a terrible time with it and I would feel awkward. And so there were just all those different things that again, you have to always know, is this, for lack of a better phrase, being true to myself or not. And
right.
You know, with teen, with Miss, whatever, you always have to make sure you're actually expressing who you really are, not just doing what you think needs to be done to win a pageant.
Absolutely love that. And can I just say that piece that you played is extremely difficult. And if you just like gave a wink to the audience, all of a sudden I'd be like, whoa, too much. I love how you're like, that's cringe and I'm not doing it. That's the moral of the story. If it makes her cringe, she's just going to say no.
Yes, honestly, I think that's what people need.
You gave a beautiful, inspiring answer, and the only thing I took away was cringe.
I mean, it's a good moral of the story, right? If you cringe, don't do it. So
now you guys know what quote I'm going to be emphasizing when I do a recap. Okay, so this is a very long answer because Teresa is saying accomplished is an understatement. She's kind of like Wonder Woman, and she's like going to be humble and be like, "That's not true," but she's literally like Miss America's just like something like, oh yeah, she was Miss America too. And I'm not exaggerating. So let's read the essay I wrote about Teresa. She's like, oh gosh. So you graduated early from Scotts Bluff High School in the spring of 2010 after taking a double load of classes throughout high school. You know, simple, basic. Teresa was named a salutatorian for the Scotts Bluff class of 2010. Then in 2012, you enrolled as a student at Patrick Henry College. In 2018, you announced that you had joined the Air National Guard as an Airman First Class while continuing your education at UC Berkeley School of Law, where you will graduate from in 2021. You now serve as a member of the Wyoming Air National Guard in the 153rd Force Support Squadron. You also graduated from your basic combat training class in the top 10%. Okay, so that's just like a light list of, you know, things she's done. Literally an absolute boss. Wow. That is a very impressive list. And you are clearly very smart graduating early and now you're in law school and all that good stuff. So I have a couple questions tied to this. I'll try to split them up as best as I can. First off, I do want to know, how did Miss America help you with your education? I mean, in not only just scholarship money, because that's evident, but how do you think you know, transitioning from being Miss America to then being a college student, do you think that helped you in any way? And also, what made you decide to take the path of law school?
Yeah, certainly. So it definitely did help, first of all. Scholarship-wise, for sure, we all know that. But in some unexpected ways, too. For example, my undergrad, once I won Miss America, I agreed to do sort of, you know, promotional efforts with them and that sort of thing for a full-ride scholarship.
Oh.
So certain things like that, you know, you can play your cards and then, you know, use the scholarship for other things. So there's more than just the scholarship dollars themselves, right, that can come with that opportunity. And then, yes, as far as even just succeeding in academics, having that experience in so many ways through what I did as Miss America, experience with nonprofits, experience with the military, experience with businesses all over the country and all over the world. I mean, that is such an education in many different industries, in different sectors, everything, that was invaluable. So my undergrad was in government, which is basically political science undergrad, and then law school. In both of those settings, I have found, and I guess this might come across wrong, not to toot my own horn, but in classes, you pretty much have some real life experience regarding basically every topic that you talk about, right? So every time you're in a class and the subject matter may be things that other people are just dealing with theoretically, you have some real life experience with that. And that's what, you know, I've seen throughout my education and now in law school even, that having that time of doing work in so many different areas and just having these very diverse experiences has made it where I can speak to that in classes and have a deeper understanding of all the material that we're learning and working with. And then in work as well, you know, when I started working for the law firm that I'll be working with after I graduate, being able to have, you know, that experience working with businesses already, showing that you've had the professional experience and knowledge and again, just that real life tangible efforts with so many different areas that you wouldn't have had otherwise. That's made a big difference for sure. And I do think that that's invaluable when you're in school. As everybody knows, learning from books is one thing, learning from life is a whole different thing. And if you can bring those two together, it creates a totally different experience.
Absolutely. That is very interesting. And you're literally everything I want to, because I'm studying political science right now and want to go to law school. So you're like,
wonderful. Yes. Oh, your other question. Yeah. Was how I decided that's what I wanted to do. So I had known that I wanted to be a lawyer ever since I was 8 years old. There was never anything else I wanted to be. I was never, you know, a little girl who was like, oh, I want to be a princess or a ballerina or this or that, or not that those things are bad, obviously, but I ended up becoming sort of a princess. So, you know, but a lawyer was truly the only thing I ever said I wanted to be. I would tell everyone who would listen to me that I want to be a lawyer, a judge, president, and a Supreme Court justice, right? And that was my plan. All the way through to the day I died, I would be on the Supreme Court till I died, right? So that was always the plan. Miss America became a kind of change of plans, but ultimately throughout my experience at Miss America, I realized the pieces that I loved had to do with the reasons I already knew that I wanted to go into law, the elements of public speaking, certain elements of changing policy and law and working with government, right? But the pieces that I didn't enjoy as much, trying to be in entertainment and doing commercials and doing some modeling and different things, I realized I don't want to do this long term as a career, but I am glad to have reaffirmed that there are several pieces of this that I really love so much and that I can use in a legal career, right? So that kind of affirmed it all the more for me, which was great. So went back to school, started school, I guess, started college there, and then went through to law school just like I had initially planned, but just in a whole different timeline than I had expected.
Absolutely. That is incredible. And I love how you were like 8 years old and you were like, I want to be a lawyer. I want to be president. And guys, honestly, Teresa Scanlan ran for president. I think a lot of what we're dealing with right now would be solved. I would vote for you.
Oh, goodness.
But you step in there and be like, boys, move aside. I've got this. And I would be here for it. She's like, no.
Now I have two votes, you and my mom. So that's great. That's good to hear.
Oh, I'll have my family back you up. Don't worry. Teresa, I should be your hype woman. Like, this is ridiculous.
Hey, manager, here you come.
I mean, I'm going to put it on my LinkedIn. So anyway, I do have a question about the Air National Guard, but I do want to ask before I forget, you went to college after winning Miss America, which is a really rare path, like you've said. Did your classmates comment, like, I'm sitting next to Miss America in my bio class right now? This is weird. Like,
luckily, they were really, really great. I was a little concerned about that, especially it being a really small school. I went to a very tiny undergrad college, Patrick Henry College. I think there were about 350 students total in the college, right? It's very small. So that actually ended up working to my favor because everyone was just so great. They were very cognizant of the idea that I wanted to be, and they wanted me to be a totally regular person in college, right? And so, you know, I can say, like, my track record there was never having been asked for an autograph, never being asked for, you know, a picture together under the circumstances of, you know, my title, whatever, which was great. It honestly was such a good feeling for people to be that respectful, for all of my classmates to really just put so much effort into making me feel welcome and normal and not like I was constantly being watched as something like different. So I'm really grateful for that experience because I had an awesome experience throughout college made some really great friendships, and I really was able to feel that none of it was based on the idea that I was Miss America. It was, you know, getting to know me as a person and that sort of thing. So I appreciate that for sure.
Totally. And I do want to capitalize on that because I think a lot of people who don't know much about pageants are now called competitions. You know, they might think that we do it like all for the attention, or that you may want the attention and want like all, you know, people to comment, oh, you're Miss America, like every day, but that's not really the case. It was for a greater purpose. And then when you had served, you were like, okay, now I just want to be Teresa. I don't want to be Miss America. Oh, and by the way, her name is Teresa, the other way around.
Exactly. No, you're so right. It's oftentimes, you know, you want to have, sure, a certain element of popularity and being known in order to make an impact in these very specific areas, right? But then you don't want that to always translate to every relationship and every aspect of your life where you can't have true friendships or true relationships of different kinds, right? And so, it is hard to find that balance. And I was really grateful and lucky that I was able to experience that even after winning.
So now the third part of this very long question, I want to know what made you decide to be a member of the National Guard. That was a total plot twist that I didn't expect to see, but nevertheless amazing. And I will say that one of the things I loved about your reign was you were so involved with the armed forces, like so involved with, you know, being there for the troops. I see many, many photos of you interacting with them. And of course, it's a big part of what Miss America prides herself on, but you had a lot of that in your reign, like even more than usual. Was that part of the inspiration for you?
It actually was. So I remember specifically a very vivid experience for me early on was the fact that right after I won, one of my first appearances was going to visit wounded warriors at Bethesda and Walter Reed Military Hospitals in DC, right? Because it was even before I turned 18, they had to get special authorization for me to even go into the hospital because technically only adults are allowed, not children. So I hadn't turned 18 yet. So I got to
Sarah as a child.
Exactly. It was like 1 week before I turned 18, but still. So I went in and, you know, started meeting with all of them were men. And it hit me really hard specifically because when I won, so much of the talk was around my age. And so it was all like, oh, the 17-year-old, so amazing. Like your life changed completely. And then visiting so many of these men, many of them were 18 and 19 years old. Right. And they had just lost one limb, several limbs, that kind of thing. And so in talking to them, I felt, I don't know if guilt is the right word, a sense of obligation and responsibility though, and definitely appreciated the gravity of the fact that yes, my life had changed in a very significant way at a young age, but their life had just changed in a very significant way at a young age, in a totally different way, right? And so, you know, I went there for morale visits and signed autographs and took pictures and talked, and they were so great, always joking around, having, you know, they were probably more positive than I was in that situation for sure. And it just made me feel like, yes, I knew what I was doing was important in those visits, but I felt like I needed to do more. And so ever since then, I had felt a sense of obligation that I needed to actually tangibly serve in some way. It wasn't going to be enough to just do what I was doing. So in working with the military, that was a great thing for sure, but I consistently felt that I could do more than just like morale visits, right? So I knew that I wanted to do something to serve in a more physical way. And initially I figured I would join active duty after graduating law school and do JAG work. So I went to visit the USS Abraham Lincoln, which is an aircraft carrier in off the coast of Bahrain in 2012, after my year, but still related. And went there, visited all the sailors on board. There's about 3,000 people on the aircraft carrier, right? Did some performances with the ship's band, sang, did all sorts of stuff. It was a lot of fun. We had a great time. But on the ship, I met the JAG there, the attorney who stays on the aircraft carrier and advises the commander of all sorts of things in international relations. I mean, they're right there on the coast of Bahrain, right near Iraq and Afghanistan. It's in a fairly tense environment where it's for peacekeeping purposes only, but still you have to be, you know, ready for anything at all times. And the attorney's job there was so fascinating to me and so cool that that's what I wanted to do. I thought, you know, I'm going to go to law school, become a JAG like this officer, and go into these situations and advise on international law. So that was my idea initially. And even though that changed, the idea of serving in the military was still like something that I was going to do no matter what. So after having my son, I realized active duty was probably not going to be for me. Doing the long deployments might not be as great of a plan. And so I decided to do the National Guard instead, which was a great compromise of still being able to serve, but doing so while maintaining my other priorities and obligations, which I've just loved. I mean, I've been so excited about it, absolutely loved it. Right now, I'm in a very service capacity where I do food, fitness, and lodging services for the forces. Once I graduate law school, then I'll apply to commission as an officer and then become a JAG, and I'd like to do JAG work ultimately.
You are so cool. Like, I don't even know what to say. I expect myself to be, like, so witty with my comebacks. I'm like, man, she's just so cool, and she's so nice, and, like, so brave, and you are amazing. I really just, I don't even know how to follow that up, but I will say that I think it's so impressive how, you know, connecting with those armed forces and being with them, and, you know, you leveled with them. You didn't come in there being like, I miss America, and, you know, all this. You were like, no, I'm grateful, and I want to know your story, and I want to be there, and then ultimately that led to a passion that's now leading to a career. And in the midst of that, I just do not want to forget that you said, you know, now that I'm a mom, and I was like, she's a mother too. Like, how does she do it all? And can I just say, your son is so adorable. I saw a picture of him with like headphones and mask on the plane, and I was like, he's so cute.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
So you're like Wonder Woman. And you also mentioned that this was just like a minimal part of what you said, but that you sang with the band when you went on the ship. And I'm like, oh yeah. And she's a singer too. Great, Teresa. Make us all look bad and unaccomplished.
Oh my goodness. No, I try to sing. I mostly sing with other people. I'm not much of a solo singer. So if I'm with a group, fine. I can kind of make my way, but it was never my top talent. And my very first pageant, I sang, and never again. I watched the video, I listened to the recording, and I was like, no, never again gonna sing for a pageant. So then I played piano. That was a much better decision.
Guys, comment down below if you want Teresa to drop her first recording. She will never do that. But no, that doesn't even matter, because this is the perfect segue for your actually really good talent. No shade to your singing, I'm sure it's great. But your amazing talent is piano, and this leads to my next question. So during the Miss America 2011 competition, you performed a piano performance of Whitewater Chopsticks, for which you won the Preliminary Talent Award for good reason. So I want to know, when did you start playing piano, and what led you to choose that piece? And also, just like a little question, if you remember, what is it like performing like on a national stage piano, particularly because for me, I did piano as a kid, but I always remember before every performance, my hands would shake, and other girls have told me that that happens, and that it's also really cold backstage, so you have really cold, shaky hands, and then you also have the pressure of performing in front of millions of people. So if you could remember to just tell me how you would do that, that'd be great.
Oh, goodness. Yeah, a couple stories there. So the piece, first of all, was just from my piano teacher in Gary, Nebraska, Robin Brenning. She taught me since I was 7 years old when I started piano, taught me for 10 years. And she was amazing because even though I was being classically trained and she was trying to get me to play these classical pieces, she knew I wasn't into classical as far as performing it myself. I love listening to classical, not playing it. But she also knew that if I was preparing for pageants and other talent competitions where I needed something that had performance value, right? And something that a lot of, I think, instrumentalists forget with pageants is that most of your judges aren't going to have that much music training often, especially with instruments. And so you want something that's a great performance, but it's not always the most technical, honestly. So I was nowhere near where I needed to be as far as skill level with piano. I'm about intermediate. I've never been advanced. But, and so the
girl,
the,
that's not true.
Well, okay, it's a technical term though, right? So with piano pieces, there's technically a skill level that will be like on there, right? That are considered intermediate, advanced, that type of thing, right? So, that's where I was, and she found this incredible piece by an amazing composer that sounded, when she played it for me the first time, oh my gosh, of course I was like blown away. And I was like, yes, I have to learn to do that. I don't think I can, but I'm gonna try it anyway, right? So learned that piece. What ended up happening was that when I was preparing it to compete for Miss America, the Miss America organization has to get authorization, right, for the copyrights on every piece that's played during the pageant. So they had to contact the composer and tell him. Well, come to find out, he lived in Fort Collins, Colorado at the time, which was like an hour or two away from where I was living in Nebraska. So he reached out personally and said, hey, I just found out you're playing my piece for Miss America. I'd love to work with you on it. So we started working together. I went there, met him. And so when I initially played it, the 90-second version that my teacher and I had done, he goes, oh, no. It should be played much faster. He added in like 4 more pages of music to the same 90 seconds and had me play it literally as fast as I could. So it transformed the whole piece. Initially, I had this whole different idea in my head of what it was supposed to be, but here's the composer giving me his vision for what the song needed to be. We changed it. We added in, you know, certain things into this 90-second version and perfected it. And so I ended up playing it, of course, for Miss America. And then after, the year after I, when I gave up my title, the following year, he and I played it in a music video, did a CD with all piano music of him and me, and we collaborated on an album together, which was just a mind-blowing experience. And so that was really, really cool to do.
So Teresa, what do you think?
What do I think? I think you're going down.
You do realize that I'm your mentor.
And I'm your number one student.
So you think you can take me?
I don't think. I know I can take you.
Then let's do this.
Bring it on.
Then when I played it at Miss America, the story about that, you're very right, where you, well, at least I, shake like crazy, very nervous every time. Because with piano, I don't feel like there's any way to be, at least for me, to play perfectly, right? So you always know something's going to go wrong. You just don't know what or how bad it's going to be. So you muddle through, you make it work, but you just never quite know. So the problem was, at the final night of Miss America competition, I was the first to be called for talent. So we're sitting up on stage, right? And there's all of the girls lined up getting ready for talent. And they told us when we were getting ready, they said, oh yeah, you can sit there on the bench and finish getting ready because, you know, they'll call you up. So some girls were tying their, you know, point shoes or stretching or doing whatever to get ready. So I thought, okay, no big deal. I'll sit here and put my earrings in. And I had these big red chandelier earrings, right? And I was the first to be called and my earrings still weren't in.
All right, ladies, the first of 10 performers in the talent competition is by Miss Nebraska.
So I started walking to the piano, still putting my earring in, and honestly started panicking. It seems like such a small thing, but was thinking like, do I just drop this earring? Do I keep struggling? Because now I'm nervous, right? So now I can't find to actually put the earring in. So I thought, do I put it on the piano and then start playing? What do I do with this earring?
Maybe I'll play with one hand and hold the earring in the other. Right? The audience, you know?
Exactly. And so in the video, really, of the TV competition, you can see me still putting my earring in as I'm going to the piano and sitting down. Finally got it in, luckily, because otherwise I don't know what I would have done. And I sat down at the piano, and I'm, of course, super nervous and flustered from all of that. And then the producers are yelling in front of the stage, go, go, go! Like, we have to get, you know, we have to move on with the pageant. I have to There was no time to even take a breath or anything, so I just started, like, right away as fast as I could. My leg was shaking so bad. I think my leg was shaking worse than my hands, that it was, you know, hitting the top of the piano as it was shaking, as I was trying to press the pedal. So, you know, my piano performance the final night was not my finest hour, for sure. I can't listen to it now because it's so muddy, it's so shaky, it's so, oof, it was rough.
So I will not be inserting a clip of her performance. The earring struggle I will be, because that is iconic and it has to be in. But her piano performance, I think there's a performance of you on Preliminary, during Preliminary's performance.
That's better. I like the Preliminary night
better. I will put that one in. But dare I say that I would be more scared to perform the piece in front of the composer or next to the composer than at Miss America. You both are terrifying, absolutely. But that is
true.
Scary. And then he adds in, let's just add in 4 more pages, like times 10, the speed, and you do you. And you're like, I don't want to do that.
Exactly.
Please don't make me do that. Exactly. That's terrifying.
I know. Yeah. And that's true. It can be, maybe that's why I got the pressure of doing it in front of the composer out of the way. And yeah. Then it was all good from there. But yeah, it turned out okay. Still play that piece to this day. You know, it's one of those that I think I'll never forget now.
Playing Calvin Jones's White Water Chopsticks on the piano, here is Teresa Scanlan, Miss Nebraska.
Thank you.
Miss Nebraska.
Well, you said something interesting that stuck out to me, besides like the whole earring and the sweating and that leg hitting, that was very intense. I was like, I felt like it was me for a second, but you said that you can hear the producers screaming, go, go, go. You guys can hear them? Like,
oh, right. Yeah, they're standing right there. The cameras just aren't showing them. And so a lot of times, you know, they're even, sometimes they can be on stage, and as long as the camera is not shooting toward them, they're directing people, they're doing things, they're talking, whatever. And so, yeah, the problem, I think at that time, I'm not sure what it is now, but we had like 2 hours or something, right? And no matter what, if the pageant went long, the ABC was gonna like cut to the next thing before we saw who was crowned. So we had to fit it in the 2 hours. And so they knew, you know, we're on a tight schedule. So you did not even have a second to like take a breath. You just had to keep going. So, you know, changing outfits was a minute, 2 minutes, it's super fast. It was pretty crazy, pretty intense.
I don't even know how to handle it. Cause number one, you have the anxiety of being called like, oh my gosh, it's me, exciting. Yeah. But then you're like, oh my gosh, it's me. Earring, Swiss shaky hands, producer screaming. It literally sounds like every pageant girl's worst nightmare. You're like, these things sound so small. No, they don't. This sounds like a nightmare. But to me, someone who likes classical music and likes piano, you sounded absolutely great. And I mean, you won. So clearly it was very impressive nonetheless. And now
whatever you can do to operate under pressure, that's a major test of it right there. So.
Yeah, I would say so. And you know, I can't even, I'm great anxiety, like through the roof, but I think that you sounded incredible. And now that leads me to move on to my next question. So, you were in the Planet Hollywood era when Miss America was in Las Vegas. Right. For those of you who don't know, Miss America is traditionally in Atlantic City. Now it's in Connecticut, but for a time it was in Las Vegas. So, and we're, who knows where it will be next? We don't know, but you were part of that era. And, so I do want to, my first question, were you guys there for 2 weeks or 1 week? Because I know sometimes you guys, it mixes it up.
I think it was closer to 2 weeks. It might have been about 10 days to 2 weeks. Okay. Actually, no, I think it was 10 days because I don't think we were there prior to New Year's Eve, and the pageant was January 10th or 11th, I think. So I think it was about exactly 10 days. We got there right after the new year, and then had the 10 days leading up to the final pageant. And it's pretty intense regardless. I think, you know, a week or 2 weeks has its pros and cons for sure, because while 2 weeks takes more endurance, 1 week can be so much poured into just that short time, because those 10 days were early in the morning to late at night every single day. And so it's funny, most people will tell you competing at Miss America honestly becomes a matter of who's still standing. Like, it's really just, you know, if you have not been able to survive the marathon of lack of sleep and so much work and manage to not get injured, not get sick, not get anything, then guess what? You win at the end of the 2 weeks, right?
Because it's for games, but with a lot more data.
It's a tough process. It really is. And it's so much to go through leading up to trying to do your best at the competition. And you've just been through 10 days of all of this.
I mean, truly, and like you said, like, you were young. Like, some of these girls have, you know, you did teen, but teen is a whole different ballgame than Miss America, and that must have just been a lot. Like, it must have been a lot to handle. I mean, I think it would be for any girl. It's a very intense week. I heard that you're catching naps wherever you can, your feet are hurting, your face hurts from smiling so much, and in addition to doing opening number, which was a big thing back in those years, like, training for that, you know, choreographing the pageant and such, you also have appearances around, you know, the city, and you're doing that as well. So it's very intense. I'm sure very tiring.
Yeah. And I think one thing that, worked for me and that I always give as advice is, to really prioritize throughout that time, what's most important to you. Because for example, the only time they gave us to work out if we wanted to was at like 4 a.m. before anything else started. And I decided for myself, it wasn't worth it. For those last 10 days, I thought whatever marginal value I got in working out for a few days was not worth the lack of sleep. So I decided to just sleep as long as I could, sleep whenever I could, not worry about working out. And that, I think, helped. There were a lot of girls who got sick. I think it was almost up to half of the girls got sick at some point. I didn't, so I felt really good about that. That way you don't miss rehearsals, you don't miss anything. And then, yeah, you have appearances usually every evening, dance rehearsals for like 8 hours a day, all sorts of other things going on. And then one piece that you don't realize is all of the filming commercials, filming extra pieces for the TV show itself. So we would be, you know, outside in the cold. Yeah, it was Vegas, but January was still freezing cold, especially at night on the roof. We would be standing there and the helicopter coming through to get this one shot, and we had to do it like 30 times. And so everybody's complaining and cold and hurting and all of this. And honestly, I think mainly it's just keeping a positive attitude throughout it, because if you can have fun with it, and if you can just realize, hey, I'm probably never going to do this again, so I might as well, you know, just enjoy it right now, not complain, not worry, that makes it a lot more manageable, I think. So then you can actually have fun and enjoy that time.
I love that you said that about positivity. I mean, my show is called The Silver Lining. It's literally all about finding positivity in every situation you can. And like you said, you know, you only get to compete for Miss America once. You only get to be Miss America once, but in the event that you don't win, you only get that time at that competition once. And so I love that you soaked it in and you really embraced it. And as challenging as it is, you know, you were grateful for it. And ultimately, that's what led you to your win. Like you said, it's a survival of the fittest. If you can handle the appearances, because that's just the tip of the iceberg. It's overall in a grueling year. You're constantly traveling. And you mentioned in your article that I read too, you know, someone else authored it, but it was with your quotes. You said that it's kind of a year where they're telling you what to do, what to wear, where to go, when to be there. You're not late, you know, and it's very stressful. It's a job. And I feel like a lot of people overlook the fact that, you know, you're representing the nation. You know, it's hard enough winning it, but then being it is, you know, the competition's just like a little tippy taste of how hard it is.
Yeah, absolutely. And when, you know, when we had talked before, as you mentioned, it's changed over the years, but when I was competing, for sure, it was very much controlled. And I think in some ways, now looking back, I realize I do think that was a benefit of being younger, is that really that level of control didn't bother me. It didn't really stress me out or make me upset, because I didn't have, I don't know. I don't think I had had the years of kind of doing my own thing and all of this that made it a more difficult experience, which it can be for some people. So even though it probably wasn't ideal and they've made some changes since then, partially due to that, for me, it was actually okay. Everything was controlled and managed and this and that. But I still, again, I felt like I was having a great time, making the most of these opportunities, being able to do plenty of things that I'd never again be able to do. So it's just a matter of picking your battles. You know, they certainly, it can be interesting when you're constantly being told what to wear and different things to do, but you do choose your battles and decide, is this actually an issue that is worth kind of pressing on, or is it something that's no big deal, right? At one point during my year, apparently I had some complaint from someone about a particular pair of shoes that I wore that they didn't like, and so they complained to the office and I wasn't allowed to wear that pair of shoes anymore. And so it was just things like that, though, that I would take a second and I'd think, eh, it's not really worth picking a fight over, right? Like, if I don't wear those shoes, I don't wear those shoes, but it's not that important to me. Now, if they were important and they had some, like, sentimental meaning, maybe that would be different. But in most of those cases, it was kind of just, yeah, this is silly, but just let it go in order to keep doing your best.
And like you said, it's not like you were really sacrificing any big source of individuality, because you even mentioned when I was even a teen, I knew that I was not going to sacrifice being Teresa for the sake of winning. Yeah. And that's why you didn't win, because when you were yourself, you won Nebraska and Miss America. It wasn't a matter of you weren't good enough. It was a matter of, I'm not right for this.
Exactly. That was where I drew the line for sure. You're exactly right in that. I was so grateful that throughout the year, at the end, I could look back and say, I never once had to do something I wasn't comfortable with, you know,
right.
They were always very good about making sure I didn't have to do any appearances I wasn't comfortable with, didn't have to say something or endorse something that I wasn't completely proud of, you know, just all those things, the things that really mattered to me were in place. So then I just didn't worry about the other stuff.
Absolutely, and I do appreciate that, because I don't want people to think that Miss America is oppressive or controlling. It's just that it's gotten so much better over these last few years. And, you know, Mallory Hagan also said the same thing as you, that she was controlled, but since then she's seen a lot of growth in that regard. So I do want to comment on that. But, you know, like you said, you weren't made to be uncomfortable, and you handled it with such grace in class. And, you know, that leads me to now your win, you know, winning the thing. You know, I want to know what was going through your head, because you watched the video, you can see you're shocked. And I do want to comment, I did write this down, that you already mentioned this, but let me just emphasize that she was the first Miss Nebraska to ever claim Miss America, which is already big enough. But she was the youngest in 74 years at 17. She was the youngest you could be. She made the age cutoff by a week. With all those factors in mind, what was going through your head when you won? What did that feel like?
Hey guys, thank you so much for tuning into my channel today. Your support means the world to me. If you like what you saw, please subscribe to my channel and like and comment on my videos, because your support is what fuels my ability to make content. I'll see you guys next time, and once again, thanks for joining me for another episode of The Silver Lining. Love you guys, bye!